We're doing a format just a little bit different this morning. We're going to move the prayer time and the announcements at the end. And so if you need a Bible, our ushers, Wade's got some right there. And let me just tell you about the message this morning. It's titled The Wilderness. And we're back in Romans. You know, we're going between Romans and Exodus. And in Exodus, Moses has just spent this 40 years in the wilderness, God preparing him. And here in Romans, Daniel did an incredible job last time with chapter 7 and hitting the legalism aspect. And Daniel came from a legalist background, and so that was just perfect. And there's another correlation with Romans chapter 7, and it's to the wilderness. And so here we are in Romans chapter 7, and we're in Exodus, and these things are tied together, and it's amazing how God just weaves as we go back and forth between the New Testament and Old Testament. He just weaves it together, and it's incredible. Well, not only that, if some of you should have got a text if from the church this week, the other day. If you didn't, we don't have your cell phone, or we don't know your provider. We need to know the cell phone and provider. And if you want to get that to us, just fill out one of those cards in the seat back in front of you, put it in the offering box. We don't send one out, just maybe two or three times a year. And just it's really just in case there's a change in the facility or whatever, we can let everybody know. But anyway, send a text out because our Through the Word app, we just started Deuteronomy and with Pastor Ken Graves. And a lot of you know Ken Graves. And so I thought, well, hey, I'll let everybody know. Ken's a great guy from Bangor, Maine. And that started like Thursday and Friday. So this morning, even though after I send the text out Wednesday, I failed to listen to it. So this morning I'm like, well, shoot, what if someone listened to it and says, hey, that was great, and I didn't listen to it. So I'm like, I better listen to it. So I click on it this morning, and he's starting Deuteronomy, and he's talking about the wilderness, and he's comparing that to this wilderness experience in our lives. So the same thing. So God's at least speaking to me in triplicate here. And so this message, I think, of course, is addressed to me, maybe, but I would imagine it's for a lot of you as well. And so remember the first section of the book of Romans, chapters 1 through 3, they're about condemnation. And you remember Paul classified all people into these four different groups, which all of us fall into. They're groups of people that have been condemned by the law as sinners. We as human beings, we live in a society, right? We're social beings. We like to say we're civilized or civil. And so for us to live together in harmony, we've created rules and laws of the land. And even when playing a game together, there's always rules that are established and agreed upon before we play the game, right? The National Football League, for example, has a rule book. And quite often they adjust the rules for the best interest of the players and their safety. They've been doing that a lot to really keep the players safe. And, of course, for fair play of competition, that's a big emphasis on the rules. So along with the rule, there's a penalty prescribed for those who violate the rule. And the penalty is always advantageous to the other team, right? And so everyone knows the rules, and sometimes they violate a rule. They get caught violating the rule. The whistle's blown, the yellow flag flies in the air, the judgment's made, the violator's found guilty, the penalty is prescribed. They keep on playing the game. We like to think God's law works that same way, you know, that it's a set of rules that we've agreed to abide by. And like a football player, we like to push the limits. We like to see how far we can bend the rule before we get a penalty called against us. And when we do get a penalty called against us, you know, we'll accept the penalty. And we accept it as payment made in full for the violation. And then we keep on playing the game like it's football. And we like this idea. I mean, it sounds good to us because we're in complete control of the situation. We're free to do whatever we want, so we think. And we're willing to take the chance of getting caught. And if we do happen to get caught violating the law, if we can't talk our way out of it or pay our way out of it with a good lawyer or whatever, we're willing to pay the penalty. And then we figure, well, it's all done. We're back to square one, even Steven. We paid the penalty on our own violation. We paid for it by ourselves. We're all squared up. It's water under the bridge. Well, God's law, it works a little different than that. God's law is not about physical actions, as Paul established in chapter 7. God's law is not about what we do physically, like the law of the land or like the rules of football. Those laws, those rules are about physical actions. It makes no difference, you know, what you're thinking about. You can think some pretty awful things about people. A football player can think how he would love to hit the quarterback so hard that he comes up with a concussion, that the quarterback comes up with a concussion. Or the tackler, I guess, as long as someone comes up with a concussion, we know it was a good hard hit, right? And so they can think about that, and it doesn't matter until they do it. Well, Paul tells us that the law is spiritual. It's not physical. It's not about what we do. It's about what we're thinking of doing. It's about our desires. And Jesus made this very plain as he taught the Sermon on the Mount. And we're going to look at Matthew chapter 5 here. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 21, Jesus says, "You have heard that the ancients were told, 'You shall not commit murder.' And whoever commits murder shall be liable to the court. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother shall be guilty before the court. And whoever says to his brother, 'You good for nothing,' shall be guilty before the Supreme Court. And whoever says, 'You fool,' shall be guilty enough to go into the fiery hell." Verse 27, "If you've heard that it was said, 'You shall not commit adultery.' But I say to you, everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart." God's law is spiritual, as Jesus informs us, and as Paul informs us, and as Daniel informed us last time in Romans. Paul's law is not a set of rules to follow to play a game by. God's law was given as a test, a schoolmaster, it's called. And remember what the purpose of a test is. The purpose of a test is to reveal the truth. You know, when you take a test in school, the purpose is to reveal whether or not you've learned what you've been taught. The test doesn't teach you anything. It's just taken to reveal what you already know. If you're having a medical problem, the doctor decides to take a blood sample and test it to see if they can find out what the problem is, the blood test doesn't give you the problem. The blood test doesn't fix the problem. The blood test only reveals the truth about what the problem is. Or hopefully it's supposed to work that way, right? Well, God created a society, a civilization, a social union, maybe we can say. He created a habitat, or let's call it maybe a plantation, or in the South, right, or an estate. And in God's plan, us human beings, God's created beings, we were designed to live with God here on the plantation. We were designed to abide with him. But apparently, God did not want a household of robots. So God desired that we would freely choose to live with him, as he has freely chosen to live with us. And so in order to reveal the truth of man's heart, God presented a test or a rule, a choice to make. And Adam and Eve were presented this choice, and both of them chose themselves over God, knowing that the penalty of that choice was death. They knew what the penalty was. So God, because he's a God of love, he honored that choice that Adam and Eve made, and they were escorted off the plantation so they could live the life on their own without God, just as they had freely chosen to do. The penalty of that choice was death. The penalty was death, and death on multiple levels, as we're going to see. First and foremost, they died spiritually right away, which meant they could no longer commune with God. God is spirit, therefore he communes, he abides, or he lives with those in spirit. Well, Adam and Eve, they died spiritually right at that moment that they chose death. So they could no longer commune with God. Secondly, they began the process of dying physically. Thirdly, in order for us human beings to have an opportunity to commune with God and abide with him, live with him, he, God, had to die physically as well. And since God is a spiritual being, part of God, the part that's referred to as the Son of God, allowed himself to be born in a human body in a supernatural way without having a human father, the Son of God, God in a human body, Jesus Christ, then allowed himself to be put to death in our stead. And so the second section of the book of Romans, chapters 3 through 5, is about our justification. Just as if I'd never sinned. Just as if you had never sinned, as we had never sinned. So in order for us to be justified, God had to become a man and die physically for us. So God creates this incredible habitat. We call it the universe. He fills it with all kinds of animals and plants and water and sky. It's just a paradise, an incredible place to live. He creates human beings in his own likeness. We're made in God's likeness to be his children so that we can hang out together on this awesome plantation that's just teeming with life and that we could just live together and enjoy life together with God, with our Creator, who allows us to call him Father. But instead, man chose death. You know, I wonder how that made God feel, that we would choose death over living in a perfect paradise with him. I mean, I can't speak for God, but I know I'd feel pretty horrible, right? Am I that bad that people would rather die than live with me? So God says, okay, you know, even though you chose death over me, I'm going to choose death as well, so that you don't have to suffer the consequences of choosing death. And so now we, you and I, we have an opportunity to choose God over death. And if we choose God over death, if we accept this free gift of God's grace, God will make us justified. It'll be as if we never chose death to begin with, which puts us back in this place where we can live with God, where we can abide with him, where we can hang out together and live with him as he intended, being his children, being able to call him Father, Dad. So first, we're condemned by the law, by the test. Adam and Eve, it was just a one-question test. That's all it took to reveal to them, you know, what they had chose, that they had chosen death over God. Well, as the generations progressed, God gave more laws, more rules, in order to reveal the truth to those generations about their own hearts. And how they have chosen death over God as well. So the law, the test, it condemns us. Because it reveals the truth about our hearts. It just shows us what we are. So God chooses to die in our place. And this gives us another opportunity to choose him over death. And if we do, when we do, we are made justified in God's eyes. That means we've been forgiven by God for choosing death over him in the first place. And the truth of us choosing death, it's revealed in all these failed test questions, all those violations of the law that we've encountered all our lives. Sometimes we think, well, you know, God can forgive me for this, but he can't forgive me for that. I mean, that's just too horrible. But you see, it's all the same thing to God. It's all the laws, all the rules, they're just test questions to reveal the status of our hearts to us. God already knows the status of our hearts. This test isn't for his benefit. It's not news to him. It's so that we will know that we have chosen death over him, over God. Well, by the sacrificial death of Jesus on the cross, we're given this second opportunity to choose God over death. And once we've made that choice, we've been made spiritually alive. Our spirit component that had died with Adam, that we were born with dead, it's now been revived. It's been reborn. Jesus says a man must be born again. That's what he's talking about. God has breathed new life into us, into that spirit. So the third section of the book of Romans, chapters 6 and 7, is about sanctification, meaning to be made holy or to be made set apart for use by God. And this is where, as Christians, we seem to have the most difficulty, because there's a little problem. You know, when Adam and Eve died spiritually, and when we were born with this dead spiritual component, our flesh, the desires and whims of our physical body, they took over the driver's seat. That's what was driving us. That's what was leading us, guiding us. And so now that God has so lovingly died in our stead and has given us this opportunity to choose him over death, totally and simply, just by believing that he did it for us, it's all him. And once we've done that, once we've been justified and our spirit component has been revived, it's been born again, well, now that new reborn spirit, it needs to take the driver's seat. But the flesh doesn't want to give it up, does it? I mean, it would have been a whole lot easier for us if we just physically died when our spirits were reborn. I mean, then we could just abide right then and there with God immediately, and we wouldn't have this battle over the driver's seat. But apparently, you know, God, I guess, figured that our immediate physical death when we accepted God's free gift of salvation, when our spirit was reborn, you know, if we dropped dead immediately right then and there, God knew that, you know, that wouldn't be so attractive to the world, right? I mean, could you imagine everybody that accepts Jesus dies immediately? People would wonder, well, how could that be a good thing, right? But it would be a good thing if you could see it, you know, if you could see beyond this physical life. But we can't, so it doesn't appear to be that way. So we're stuck in this body with a battle over the driver's seat. And so God reveals the solution to this problem through Paul in chapter 6 of Romans. And he tells us that our physical body is as good as dead in God's eyes. Our physical body with all its drives, its desires, its wants, it's been crucified with Christ on the cross. It's been buried with him in baptism. And we have been raised up in newness of life, the scripture tells us. So the consequence of Adam and Eve choosing death over God continues its effects. First, they died spiritually, right? Second, they died physically. Third, God had to die physically. Fourthly, as believers, we have to die physically before we even really die physically. You know, it was like God said, hey, you want to choose death over me? Have at it. You know, it's like going to the old country buffet, smothered and covered death on a plate. Why stop at one plate? Why not have four or five helpings of death, right? And so it's over and over and over again, this death. And so God tells us that we have physically died with Christ. That it's, we've died. We've been buried with him in baptism. But we don't believe him. I mean, I can't speak for everybody, but in my experience, it seems as if most Christians, most of us, we don't believe this, not at least not at first. And as Daniel explained last time so well, we have a problem believing that, I mean, we don't have a problem that God paid the price for all our sins, that he paid the penalty for us in the past, and we have no problem believing that. But now that we've been justified and made righteous in God's eyes, we try to conform ourselves. We try to change our own lives. You know, we try to make ourselves righteous from here on out. God made us righteous and justified in the past, but now we got it all figured out, and we're just going to try to make ourselves righteous and justified from here on out. And as Paul found out, and as you and I have found out, or will find out if you haven't, this is an exercise in frustration. In the end of chapter 7, Paul writes, starting in verse 21, I find then the principle that evil is present in me, the one who wants to do good. For I joyfully concur with the law of God in the inner man, but I see a different law in the members of my body, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner to the law of sin which is in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will set me free from this body of death? Pastor Chuck compares Romans chapter 7 to the wilderness wanderings of the children of Israel. As we're seeing in our study through the book of Exodus, the children of Israel, they're in bondage of slavery to the Egyptians for 400 years. Egypt is used as an example of the world in Scripture. And so following that example, we as people, we're born into the bondage of sin. We're born with this wicked heart, a heart that chooses death over God. And God's law, his test questions, will reveal that truth to us. So God raises up Moses in order to deliver his people out from the bondage of slavery. And so Moses understands that God wants to use him. And Moses basically says, great, I can do this. I've been trained to be a leader my whole life. I have a great plan. I just need to get the ball rolling, get the people behind me. And then I can do this and deliver the people of God. But God, as we saw last week, is not interested in Moses doing it. God is not interested in us doing it. God is interested in doing it through Moses. God is interested in doing it through us. Moses was not righteous in God's eyes. He was self-righteous. He was righteous in his own eyes. Moses spent 40 years in the wilderness. He had his own wilderness experience. 40 years of seeing what he could do by his own effort, by his own strength, by his own righteousness. And after 40 years of that, living in the desert with sheep, Moses was a very humble man. The Bible says the most humble man on earth. And what we will see as we continue our study through the book of Exodus, we'll see how God is able to use Moses now to lead his people out from the bondage of slavery, leading them to the promised land, the land flowing with milk and honey, as God describes it, meaning a very fertile land, a land with a lot of natural resources. The people's journey through the wilderness, it should have only taken a few weeks. But the people were not ready. And finally, God's able to bring them to the border of the land that he had promised to give them. And he instructed them, take possession of it. Take possession. It's yours. I've given it to you. And they send a group of spies in who come back with a negative report. And that's given to us in Numbers chapter 13. It says, when they returned from spying out the land, at the end of 40 days, they proceeded to come to Moses and Aaron and to tell all the congregation of the sons of Israel in the wilderness of Paran at Kadesh. And they brought back word to them and to all the congregation and showed them the fruit of the land. So they brought back this fruit. Thus they told him and said, we went into the land where you sent us, and it certainly does flow with milk and honey. And this is its fruit. You know, they brought it back. This must have been impressive fruit. Nevertheless, they say, they continue, the people who live in the land are strong, and the cities are fortified and very large. And moreover, we saw the descendants of Anak there. Amalek is living in the land of the Negev, and the Hittites and the Jebusites and the Amorites are living in the hill country, and the Canaanites are living by the sea and by the side of the Jordan. And then Caleb quieted the people. You know, everybody's probably getting riled up. Caleb quieted him before Moses, and he says, we should by all means go up and take possession of it, for we will surely overcome it. Caleb has faith that God's going to deliver them. But the man who had gone up with him said, we are not able to go up against the people, for they are too strong for us. So they gave out to the sons of Israel a bad report of the land which they had spied out, saying, the land through which we have gone and spying it out is a land that devours its inhabitants. And all the people whom we saw in it are men of great size. There also we saw the Nephilim. The sons of Anak are part of the Nephilim. And we became like grasshoppers in our own sight. And so we were in their sight. The Nephilim means giants, and so like Goliath would have been a descendant of them. Big guys, you know, all NFL football players or whatever. Scary. And so God delivers these people out from the hand of the Egyptians, right? Out from the bondage of slavery through Moses, from the world-dominating empire and their armies. God parts the Red Sea, this amazing event. He provides a river of water from a rock, you know, that waters several million people. He shows himself strong time and time again. God has delivered us out from the bondage of sin through Jesus Christ. God has shown himself strong to us time and time again in all different ways. God had a place for his people to reside, a place for his people to live, for his people to dwell in. God has a place for us to dwell in. A land of milk and honey. A land full, not full of natural resources, a land full of spiritual resources. A land full of fruit, spiritual fruit. But to get to this land, just like the children of Israel, there's a short journey through the wilderness. A journey that should be short. Pastor Chuck says that Romans chapter 7 is a picture of this walk through the wilderness, a picture of those that have been justified, that have been made righteous by Jesus Christ on the cross, but are now attempting to sanctify themselves. God has brought each one of us to the border of his promised land, and we too have spied it out. And we've seen the giants in the land. We've seen the fortified walls. We've seen the strongholds of the enemy. We've attempted to overcome some of these issues in our lives. We've taken on a spiritual battle with a physical law. You know, we make rules, and we attempt in our flesh to follow these rules. I mean, we're battling the enemy, the spiritual enemy, with a test question. The very question that has proven we chose death over God. That's the sword we choose to wield. Let me give you an example. I recently had a physical exam at the doctor, and it's a test. It reveals the truth about what I eat. My cholesterol is a little high. Body mass index came in overweight to obese. The potential candidate for diabetes, I don't know, and some other things too, I don't know. I'm trying to block it out. But so to avoid taking another pill, you know, of who knows what for every day for the cholesterol and all that, I figured, hey, I just need to change my eating habits, you know, or attempt to change. So I update my fitness app. I have this app on my phone, and it keeps track of the calories. I mean, and you can enter things. It even scans barcodes, you know, right off the back of the potato chip bag or the ice cream sandwich. You scan the barcode, whatever you're having for dinner. And so at the beginning of this week, you know, I told Jill, and I've been working up to this over the last several weeks. I said, all right, you know, I've done a couple of test times. I said, all right, this week, this is it. I'm going to document everything. I told Jill I'm just going to document everything, whatever I eat. Even if it's bad, this is my first rule, my first law, my first edict, right? I'm going to document everything, get it all down. And that way I figured if it's all on this list and you see how bad the list looks, hey, surely that would be enough to say no to food, right? Well, how do you think I did? And I didn't. And I didn't. I think one day I got maybe everything down, and it was such a huge list. And horrible. So a song from one of my favorite bands, it came to mind, and I found this video about this song on YouTube. And it's an expression of that frustration of living in the wilderness, the frustration that we encounter trying to sanctify ourselves by our own righteousness. And so we're going to play that video.
life, I can contend with you. Your ways are so much higher when we pass through the fire that Christ endured before us when you were in the wilderness.
Can you relate today? Has God delivered you out from the bondage of sin? Has God breathed life into your spirit? And you're now born again. By faith, you believed what God said about his sacrificial death on the cross through Jesus Christ, that it paid for your sins, that you have been forgiven, that you've been set free, and you know this and you believe this. But as Paul expressed in chapter 7, as this video has expressed, as I have expressed, are you stuck in the wilderness? Like me, are you stuck in the wilderness this morning? As God brought you to the border of the promised land, and you've seen the giants in your life. You've seen the fortified cities. You've seen the strongholds. And you know there's no way on this earth that you can overcome these things. Like me, you've tried. And you've tried and you've tried again. Only to find that it's an exercise in frustration. You know, Pastor Chuck pointed out the beginning steps of Alcoholics Anonymous, which are based on biblical principles. Number one says, we admit that we're powerless over, they say, alcohol. Fill in the blank. Admit we're powerless over this. Number two, come to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us, that there's a power that can take care of this. And number three, make a decision to turn our will, and our lives over to the care of God. I mean, if those are not the principles of what Paul is teaching about sanctification, I don't know what is. When God brings us to the border of the promised land and we see the giants, we see the fortified cities, we see the strongholds of the enemy in our own lives, we need to admit that we are powerless over them. We're not going to be able to do this on our own with rules, with the law. The children of Israel, they knew they were powerless over the obstacles in the promised land. However, they failed to believe that a power greater than themselves, the power of God, who had shown himself strong time and time again in their lives, they failed to believe that God could restore them, that God could deliver them, that God was strong enough and powerful enough to handle the enemies for them. God told them to occupy the land. They needed to occupy the land. When we see the giants, whether it be indulging in food, ice cream, nachos, French fries, whatever, whether it be the trappings of lust, computers, TVs, smartphones, they're calling it now. Anger issues in traffic, in the workplace, even with our loved ones. When we see these giants, and that's just to name a few, when we see these giants, these fortified cities, these strongholds of the enemy, number one, we need to admit that we're powerless against them. Secondly, we need to take God at his word and believe that he is more powerful than these things. I mean, is it really hard to believe that God is not more powerful than a bowl of ice cream? That God cannot prevail over a smartphone? That God cannot overcome bad traffic? Number three, we need to make a decision to turn our will and our lives over to God. We need to acknowledge that our flesh with its sinful nature is dead, that it's no longer behind the wheel, that it's now the Spirit of God that is directing our path every single step of the way. Don't make the mistake of trying to figure out how God's going to conquer these things. I've tried that. Do you remember when the children of Israel finally went into the promised land, the next generation? They finally get in there, and the first city that God had them take was Jericho. And what was the great military strategy that God told them to use to overcome this city? God had them march around the outside of the city one time for one time a day for six days. Seventh day, they circled seven times and they blew their horns and the walls came down. No person in their right mind would have ever come up with a plan like this to conquer a walled city. It doesn't make any sense. In fact, it seems absolutely ridiculous, except for the fact that God instructed it. You know, in a football game, quite often, maybe even most of the time, I'm not an expert in football, but From what I understand, the quarterback in the past used to call a lot of the plays. You know, he was the one doing the strategizing to score the goal and win the game. But today in the NFL, from what I understand, quite often the quarterback's just following directions. You know, the head coach is on the sideline, the offensive coordinators, there's guys in the booth or whatever. I don't know all the positions, but all of them in some sort of collaboration between these guys that are not in the game, they're outside the game, they're strategizing how to win the game, but none of them are actually on the field in the gameplay. You know, in a way, that's how we need to operate. We need to stop strategizing. We need to stop calling our own plays. We need to start listening to that little voice in our ear, the Holy Spirit, who is in collaboration with the head coach and the offensive coordinator and whatever. I don't know who's the Father and the Son and the Spirit, whatever you want to look at that. But they are together, one God, leading us, speaking into our ear. And as crazy or strange that the play he calls may seem, like with Jericho, we need to be obedient to it. I mean, seriously, marching around blowing horns? If this is the kind of thing that God uses to bring down a stronghold, then God could instruct us to do almost anything to bring down the strongholds in our lives. Doesn't really have to make sense, obviously. You see, the men marching around the walls and blowing their horns, they had nothing to do with bringing down the walls of Jericho. The men marching around and blowing their horns had everything to do with them believing and trusting that God was going to do it for them. They're just following orders, not following the law, not strategizing how the world might do it, not attempting to become righteous on their own efforts, but just listening to God. Listening to that still small voice of the Holy Spirit. And as crazy as it sounds, maybe like Jericho, as reckless. I mean, remember Gideon going in with just a few hundred troops against tens of thousands? Seems reckless as it might seem. God is calling the play. And if we follow his direction, stepping out in faith, trusting that he will conquer the strongholds, not us conquering the strongholds through our own cleverness or through our apps on our electronic devices, like I'm doing, or not us conquering the strongholds through our own effort, our own self-righteousness, but God conquering them and just bringing us along for the ride. You know, in battle, we're the guy carrying the flag or the guy with the bugle. They're marching around blowing the horns. Romans chapter 8, verse 1 is the answer, and in future weeks to come, we'll get further into this. Paul says, therefore, because of all that, everything we've talked about, that he's talked about, the whole book of Romans, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. For the law, what the law could not do, weak as it was through the flesh, God did, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and as an offering for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh. Verse 4, so that the requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who are according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who are according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For the mind set on the flesh is death, but the mind set on the Spirit is life and peace. Because the mind set on the flesh is hostile towards God, for it does not subject itself to the law of God, for it is not even able to do so. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. We cannot please God with flesh, with actions. Verse 9, however, you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. And if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you, But if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to him. If Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, yet the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. So then, brethren, we are under obligation, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you are living according to the flesh, you must die. But if by the Spirit you are putting to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are being led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. For you have not received a spirit of slavery leading to fear again, but you have received a spirit of adoption as sons by which we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit. The Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, heirs also. Heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for being the God that you are, for delivering us, Lord, for saving us, for making us righteous in your eyes. Lord, we thank you so much for giving us another opportunity to choose you over death, Lord, to choose you over choosing ourselves and our own will. And Lord, I think most of us have done that here already, Lord. And Lord, I think a lot of us may be in that wilderness still, in that journey that we've been delivered. You've delivered us. But we haven't taken full possession of the land, of the area that you want us to take possession of. The land full of spiritual resources, the land full of spiritual fruit, Lord. Help us, Lord, to let go of those things. Help us to just look to you to accomplish these things, to take on these strongholds of the enemy. Help us to not continue to try to do it in our own effort, by our own strength, Lord, but help us to just follow your plan. As crazy as it may sound to us, Lord, help us to hear your plan, hear it loud and clear, Lord, and help us to follow that plan, whatever it might be, Lord, that you would deliver us from these strongholds, that you would lead us into the promised land. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.